to the rehearsals before they even wear the costume. Good. But they had potential. No future for you. John came in, sort of wandered in, and Malcolm was looking for people to make up a band. I thought of him. And he did an audition, actually, in the shop in front of the jukebox, miming to some record on the jukebox, which was very funny. I remember he said, Malcolm said to him, what can you do musically? And he said, I can play a violin out of tune. And I thought, flash, come on. Very different, really. I mean, they were the pioneers of what's going on now.
Summer of Jubilee year, the Sex Pistols' second single, God Save the Queen, made number one. Jordan, a friend of the Pistols since they formed in late 75, recalls one of their earliest performances.
I remember one particular gig that was really great at Chelsea Art College, and that's when I really got the feeling that the Pistols definitely were bound to make it, because there was like people going crazy and dancing, and I really sort of defy anybody in those days to have gone to a Pistols concert and not been excited by what was going on, because there was just definite static energy in what was up there on stage. I mean, there's like three things: pogoing, spitting, and safety pins, that out-of-towners, sort of country bumpkin type people, have really latched onto. I mean, the safety pin thing was a lot to do with John, who started to sort of rip his clothes and put safety pins on them. But they really latched onto that through the press. And as soon as people feel that they should do that at a gig, they do it. And really, it was born out of something so small. It was unbelievable. Probably just like one person spat one evening. It's just amazing, it really is. And they used to spit beer and things like that.
Eric Hall, head of promotions at EMI, remembers his first meeting with the Sex Pistols after their signing in October 76.
I went into the A&R department and said, who are these crazy guys, man? I mean, who are they? This is the Sex Pistols, we just signed them. They're tremendous. And my first actual plug for them was after all this, was by phoning up the Today programme and speaking to Mike Housego, the producer. It was a really tempting decision. They phoned me and said, yes, we'd like to use the Sex Pistols, you know, will they be okay? I said, well, sure, I'm sure they'll be all right. And they were definitely, I think, goaded by Bill Grundy, because they did swear, I think they said something like fuck or whatever, very quietly, nobody really suffed it out. And he turned around and said, come on, fellas, you're going to be more outrageous than that. Come on, come on. You know, that word I really don't remember. but with something like that coming, you'd be more outrageous. And that's the worst maybe you can say to a punk band at that stage. They said, well, you know, and all these four-letter words just come out. I think prior to that show, the main board were not very happy about us signing a band like that. I don't think that show obviously may have been the final nail in the coffin, obviously. I don't know, their reasons I really don't know. They never said. All I know that we were told, we've all called into our managing director's office about a few days or whenever it was later to say that we have now dropped the Sex Pistols.
After two controversial and short-lived record contracts with EMI and A&M, in May 76, the Sex Pistols signed to Virgin Records. Simon Draper explains the success of their relationship.
Well, first of all, we're an independent record company. We don't have to answer to any boards of directors or anything. We run the company, which means, for a start, there's no problem. Secondly, I think that we possibly more sympathetic, but I wouldn't go so far as to say that, with the kind of aims that the Sex Pistols have. The Sex Pistols themselves want success on their own terms, not on any record company's terms. And they're making sure that things happen the way they want them to. And luckily, we seem to be working more or less hand in hand, in the sense that we want the same things and we want things to happen for them in the same way that they do.
Is it difficult promoting a band that basically find it almost impossible to play in this country?
Well, conventionally speaking, it would seem to be, but in fact, they've had a number one single and another number five single, so that hasn't been difficult. And they will play in this country sooner or later, I believe. I can't believe that people would continue to be so pig-headed and stupid about it, as some of the councillors up north have been. It's finding venues. I think for the Sex Pistols want to play in... They don't want to play in the conventional sort of venues. They don't want to suddenly be appearing at the Rainbow or the Hammersmith Odeon. As I say, I think it might be also a question of some of these city councils up north realising the absurdity of their stand. When you consider the kind of violence that you get at other big public gatherings and compare it with the so-called violence that has been noted at punk rock gigs, I mean, there's no comparison.
Oh, they love you sort of like fighting on the football terraces, you know, because they know where you are then. But once you do it, try to do it through music. And as you said, like, Pistols try to play. Mm. They let all these kids kick shit out of each other at football matches, but the Pistols try to play.
Mm. All they want to do is play. All they want to do is stand on stage and play their instruments, you know. They just won't let them.
It's really exciting, you know, music. Nothing like it.
The National Front can walk anywhere in London. They can go through the streets, they can do anything. It's ain't a dig at any party or saying, well, one side of the fence or the other. Mm. But while they can walk through the streets and any party, socialist works can gather and say this against them. And the Sex Pistols, try and get them a gig. Oh, no, we're not having them. But we'll have these walk through the streets because they're an acceptable evil. Mm. But the other mob, we're just a bunch of idiots who don't know what to do, so spit on old ladies and whatever it is, you know?
They're happening everywhere. In Manchester, the council closed the electric circus.
The electric circus shutting down. I mean, I come from Manchester.
There's been no trouble or nothing cut there. They're just closing down.
Yeah, you ask a councillor, why are you banning the Pistols? Mm. He said, well... Everybody else does, you know.
It's that's it. It's the old thing, isn't it? They've got a band.
That brass tax.
Well, they'll say four-letter words in this, but so does the average Yorkshire comedian in a club.
The Slits talk about the lyrics of their songs.
All right, let's do the Splits, shall we?
Yeah. it's about splitting up with a boy. No, it's just about, you know.
Yeah, about guys fucking... Hey! So drummer and bass player. Let's do the Split is about fucking guys fucking us about and we tell them to fuck off.
And we just get...
Why do we have a lie? La 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 la.
fucking
And then we've got
drink.
Slime. It's about slime.
I had a drink.
Not saying what
there.
Oh, shut up.
What about passing?
Yeah, I think it's good that that females can now get up on stage and have as much adoration as the male contingent have. I mean, it's been a man's world in that area for a long, long time now. I feel a bit sorry for bands like the Slits, who tend to get gigs mainly just because they are a girls' band, and they're not held on their merit as much as they should be, really. And they get a lot of sort of male hangers-on, sort of saying, you're great, but looking them up and down at the same time. It's a bit of a drag for them, I think. But it's good that sort of girls are getting up there now.
Maurice Oberstein, managing director of CBS, recalls his company's first interest in punk bands in late 76.
We tried, as a company, to sign what we think are the best acts available. At the beginning of punk rock, the best acts we saw were The Clash, The Stranglers, and The Sex Pistols. I would admit, though I'd hate to, that we missed The Stranglers on the basis that we conceptualized what the new wave music was about and were wrong, in that we thought the new wave music had to be young musicians, inexpert perhaps, but they had to relate to the people they were playing to on an age level. That certainly didn't turn out to be right up to this point in The Stranglers. I think it just shows a very substantial unhappiness with the fact there's nothing out there for the kids to go to. So the lyrics of The Clash, particularly, I've socially comment in a way that is anti-business, anti-establishment.
You don't get many rich kids going to school talk for 15 years that, you know, a success is having their own window in a bank, right? It's just if you're from that part of London and you're from that background, where you go to a school where they don't know your name, you know, and you're in them kind of schools where they've got no teachers, you see the same teacher maybe 2-3 weeks and they're gone, you've got classes where they just say, read this book. All you're trained for is to be in a factory at the end of 20 years, and that is the biggest insult to me, and that's what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about former rock and roll music, I'm talking about spitting on grannies. I'm just not going to have that about, you know, and people are just taking me for that. I mean, I've got fair dues. I mean, I had no hard, broken family, I had no hard life at school. I mean, I was top gauge in our school as far as blah, 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 and I got this first, that first. And then, I said, what do you want to do? We've got an opening here in, like, you know, NatWest. You can, 40 years' time, then just think you could have your own car and a nuclear family. Well, cheers, Jim, you're chucking me in at the deep end. I want that.
I think it's the message, though it's, in a sense, naive, that a young person wants to break down what he sees as being unjust, unfair. I don't think the lyrics are in the essence of the music. They are there. They are words, so they're the equivalent of a young person's love song. So they're a hate song. And I don't think it makes the kid who's buying the record or somebody dancing to it really wound up in the message that's in the music. I think the music is the message.
Eddie and the Hot Rods, one of the most energetic rock and roll contemporaries to the new wave.
Get out of timber, baby!
Thank you.
Former A&R man at United Artists, explains how the Hot Rods were one of the rock bands responsible for opening up new venues with the pub rock circuit.
Well, led into it, Vaughan Fielgers to the Hot Rods, to, through the 101ers, and I think that right. So it opened up, you know, as a pub-level rock and roll excitement. Audiences were going along just having a great time, and also it proved that they could sell records and be successful without, you know, wheeling out synthesizers and having like thousands and thousands of pounds spent on stage gear. I mean, it was back to the roots again, which enabled, you know, what's happening now to happen, I think. I probably related to what the Stranglers were doing easier at first, and I had an idea that it was going to sound good in the studio, which I wasn't sure about some of the other things at that time. And that was a band that wasn't instant. I went about 4 to 5 gigs and to convince myself that that my emotions were probably leading me the right way.
If I had to say where CBS was in relationship to punk and related to any period in history, I suppose its closest relationship is to Monterey, where out of that came a great number of exciting bands. And I think we're seeing that again. We're seeing the fact that it's a new beginning and that it's not a mechanical marketing thing that we're involved in, that it really is nothing but a new form of music. And I hope we do reasonably well by picking winners.
The record industry gets too complacent. It formalizes so much that it follows what has been successful. The record business always formalizes. And in this case, it needed to come from cliche, street level, I suppose. It's not a thing that record companies could manufacture, and I don't think they'll ever be able to get away with manufacturing it either. So the healthiest thing was that it was coming as a natural progression from the clubs, rather than, hey kids, here's a new trend for you to get into, you know.
Up to this moment in time, punk means violence, punk means bands fighting across a stage with their audience. Punk has been solely a media trip for America and the rest of the world. The great problem that those other parts of the world have is now stopping and listening to the music.
I think that they were in at the end of last year, people were a little reluctant to recognize this new phenomenon, you know, for what it was. Now every record company has to have a punk rock band.
These record companies seem to have got it under their grip, under their control again, which, you know, obviously I'm a part of, I don't necessarily see as a good thing. I think, you know, they should be fighting, they should be stay angry, because good rock and roll needs that.
Tony James and Billy Idol of Generation X talk about the reasons why new wave bands were formed.
I think the reason we formed groups was because, like, 2 years ago, there were just no exciting groups about, right? Mm-hmm. The vision we had of the Stones, the Who, Motley Hoople, the New York Dolls, right? Yeah, right? Really didn't exist on stage, okay? Because, like, we went to see groups and everyone just sat there, you know? It was like Sunday times watching some dopey group, right? And so, you know, our vision of was like a really exciting rock and roll group.
What about your name? Where's Generation X? Where did you get the name from?
It came from a sort of a book in the 60s. Mm-hmm. It's about what young people thought then, right? Yeah. You know, it was their way of expression in a way, you know, because, you know, it was about the mods and the rockers and stuff like that, about how they had to chain each other and things like that, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
We felt it meant exactly the same for us today, you know? Yeah. The futility and things around us.
How's it changed since your life, since you've been in the band?
Well, I'm now into religion now.
You are? Yeah. I see. What sort of religion?
Booze, I suppose.
Booze? Yeah. That's a religion, is it?
Yeah, it is for me, yeah. And the drums.
And the drums, right.
And Generation X.
And Generation X.
All the songs
gigging.
We sing, like, they come from, you know, from the heart, like, because right. All we want to do is give the feeling rock and roll gave to us, like, we're not interested in anything else, you know?
And it's just like, again, it's accessible, right? You know, like, you see the guys in the groups on the bus, right? And you can say, you know, what's happening, you know, and talk to them.
Like,
it's like
friends,
bringing it back to us, or people in the audience relate directly to it.
Guys in the group, in the audience, everybody's, you know, like, all mates, like friends.
But, I mean, it's just exciting again, you know? I'm going to go out and have a good time, you know, and, like, be really excited and see groups which are really exciting on stage. Okay, right?
So it's here to stay, is it?
Yeah, it's here to stay, kids.
Yes.
All across the nation.
Punk rock not only created a new sound of rough, hard-edged music, but also brought with it a new style of dress. The early effect of punk clothes was to shock the general public, especially the inventive use of the safety pin. Jordan worked at Seditionaries, the clothes shop owned by Malcolm McLaren, the Sex Pistols manager. Malcolm and his girlfriend Vivian's highly original designs formed the basis of the first punk dress. Jordan explains why they took on.
I think that young people had got to the end of their tether, really. They'd been forced to sort of buy off the peg, mass-produced clothes from places like Topshop, and there had really been nothing else for them.
Nigel Bricknell, one of the punk fashion shop owners.
And you went through the early 70s and no one sort of turned a blind eye down the King's Road, and then you started getting people wearing outrageous makeup and clothes that weren't from Take Six or the jean shops. I mean, everyone was fed up with denim. And that's when you started shocking people.
Well, because it was just to shock people at the time. I used to wear safety pins and all of that and thick eye makeup. But it was great at the time because nobody else was doing it, but now nobody bothers to even dress up. But at the time, you know, it's just a shock.
I think it's a small minority of kids who do actually do it themselves, you know. It's nice to think they do. It's a good sort of philosophy. That...
And Vivian created a new market and created something extreme, something that they could feel that they were actually doing something in. I just think that it had to happen sooner or later. And
people, like, because they've never seen anything like it before.
I think a lot of the kids face a, you know, a real grave problem, really. I know some kids, say, from Liverpool who really get beaten up a lot because of the things they wear.
Where the green was there, white on the top. And, like, where the white was there, green, like what do they call it?
I don't know.
A tie, like mixed colours. Mm. And I used to have my nose pierced with three chains. Mm. And like this rugby player type, there was five, I went to the toilet, there was five of them in there. And just as I was walking out, he goes, "Where the fucking hell do you think you're going?" I said, "I'm just going back to the dance floor." He said, "No, you're not." And he just chucked me in sort of the toilet.
It's a whole social thing, you know, right in the... I mean, as with any rock and roll fashion thing at the moment, it all ties up. Mm. Views, music, fashion, everything. I mean, makeup, the whole thing.
Because if you walk along the street, you know, you get everyone looking at you. Because if you dress normally, you don't.
had a type in on the other day, just a paper clip, right? Just a paper clip. And some bloke came and said, oh, you know, good typing. And I said, it's only a paper clip, John, do you want it? Oh, it should be in gold, won't it? I said, what are you talking about, it should be in gold? It's treating my life as a game. It's this week's trend, it's this week's fed. Punk rock, right? And as long as I don't kick them people in the arse, I'm just going to good old their nose and fucking have them. Because they deserve it, right? They just treated me, I'm a nothing, and they're on this level, right?
From left to right, Danny Baker, editor of Sniffing Glue, with Mark P., creator of Sniffing Glue, and Chris Needs, editor of the rock magazine Zigzag. Sniffing Glue was the first punk fanzine, a cheap homemade magazine that encouraged every kid to write his own. Mark explains how he first thought of it.
I listened to the Ramones record, right? And I just thought it needed to be written about in my own way, you know? Because I didn't think it was being done justice by the press, you know? They've been knocked about for being a comic band, you know? I just felt they should be written about, so that's why the first Sniffing Glue came out about the Ramones. The guy read it and he said, why don't put it out as a fanzine? I mean, I've got a big collection of fanzines anyway, so I didn't invent fanzines, you know? Fanzines have been around for a long time. I just thought of a, you know, punk rock fanzine.
Andy Chizowski, manager of the Roxy Club. The Roxy was the first and most successful London punk club, which he ran from January to April 77.
Just through chance and talking to Chelsea G in October, he put me in contact with a guy who had a club which wasn't doing very well, and we zoomed in straight away and hired it for one night in December. And just told a lot of people what was happening without advertising at all, because we just didn't like the idea of advertising. And the people who were interested would come down because they'd know what was going on, which is more the way we tend to judge and value things. And it worked. You know, people did turn up and it was sufficient to pay the rent and it was a bit of fun. This also, more importantly, convinced the person who had the club that we were having more people turning up than he was having turning up. So he was prepared to take a chance because he wasn't interested in what was happening at all, had no interest, just the money. Things sort of developed. It was like a catalyst, really.
Yeah.
So people met, bands met, they progressed, exchanged ideas, formed, and they knew that if they asked me, they could play straight away without anything else, because the fact they were linked in the same group of people and knew each other was sufficient for us to give them a try. I saw with the Roxy, it was getting famous, it was very successful, more and more people were coming down, more and more bands were forming, so the whole thing was growing. There's obviously that was going to be the club as it was.
How do you feel about the Roxy now that that's changed management?
That's a lot of shit.
Oh, it's no good now. It's no good. Used to be quite good.
So,
I think it used to happen there.
What about the Vortex then?
The best.
No, that's the best up to now. That's good. It's good, okay. You know, and you get good groups up.
Guitarist Howard Pickup and drummer Laurie Driver of the Adverts, with their roadie, talk about the difference in attitude towards punk rock outside London.
It's much more explosive out of London, up north it is, yeah.
It
means much more to me to play up north.
That's why.
Yeah,
really.
Well, not only, yeah, I suppose so. I didn't mean it that way. I meant like because the audience reaction is so great.
It's
just
but in the south, it's more of a fashionable thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it's more a trend down here, you know.
Yeah. Did you play in another band before you played?
Yeah, I played in a couple.
Whereabouts?
Yeah, Barn Dances.
Did you do a tour
down? That's right, yeah.
How did that go?
It went very well. Very
some
well.
Of it didn't.
I mean, well, it depends what you mean, how did that go? I mean, they talk about the way the audience react, like, or...
Yes, exactly, 30 days tour or something.
Well, I mean, most of the audience were, good, were very, very actually. Good. Mm. The thing is, they've read stupid papers. They've read silly papers like The Sun and... you read The Sun, do you? And The People. Oh, you read The People as well? Well, The Sun and The People, and they... print things in such a way where people believe it, you know? Mm. And they think it's the thing to do to go along to a punk and throw a bottle at you. Right. And it's not.
Definitely. The media, definitely.
Yeah.
They blow everything up.
Do you think the media has taken, has affected punk rock?
Yeah, look, definitely. What about that Daily Mirror story about punks going down to Margate? They just advertised the fight there.
It's inciting the violence, isn't it? The papers are a load of shit. And I'm saying that, it's a load of shit.
Two-faced was this water, elders taught. We're human to indulge in. We'll be right back.
Tim.
At the moment, yeah.
Well, I got songs, but we don't put them in the set.
I've got one as well.
Mine have got two bigger words in them.
Yeah.
It's about losing arms and things and blood and gore.
Looking Through Gary Gilmore's Eyes has just come out, has it?
Yes. Yeah, it came out last Friday.
That was one of Tim's songs?
Yeah.
What are the lyrics actually about?
It's about a guy in the States who has got the part of the eyes of Gary Gilmore.
No, it's about a guy who was a mass murderer and was convicted to life in prison.
That's Gary Gilmore. No, the song's about his bleeding eyes.
No, let me finish.
Gary Gilmore's dedicated his eyes to science, right?
Mm.
He donated.
It's punk, isn't it, man? Come on. He dedicated his eyes to science, right?
Wait, you?
And the song's
about science. Oh,
you saw his face.
Well, bad right. Let me finish. And this mass murderer.
This person.
He got sentenced to life in a hospital bed. Listen, he got sentenced to life in prison.
And the first thing
and
he wanted
to be executed, right?
And he put his
in front of television cameras. Right. And he donated his sight to science. And it's about a guy who's looking for his eyes. He's got them.
The late Mark Bolan, star of the early 70s glam rock, talks about the tour he had just completed with the punk band The Damned as support.
Everyone said, hey, Mark, you're crazy to do these places. We played them, we sold them all out. The Rainbow was sold out real quick, everywhere real quick. And they said, hey, they're a punk audience, my audience. I mean, it was three quarters Mark Bolan audience, a quarter Damned, and it ended up 100% a rock and roll fan club, being a Damned audience, a Mark Bolan audience, put them both together.
Some guy just said to me, like, talking about Ted, you know, and I said, well, I like rock and roll, I've got rock and roll records. He said, how could you admit that? I mean, that drastic. Oh, fucking hell, you was listening to fucking Barry last year and Barry White, don't give me that, you know.
I find that the Pistols very believable. I find the Ramones beautifully unbelievable. I mean, the nicest way. I mean, I love The Jam. The Damned, I love their songs. Stretch Your Case. In particular, is a great one, you know, and you know, whatever. But I think it's all gabba gabba, hey hey. I mean, it's all, you know. Susie's a headbanger, Ashino is a punk rocker, Deborah was a zebra, which is my first hit, right, in '67. It's all related to violence in the mind, not in the body. And I just, I want to, I think punk's got to get away from all this terrible on the streets. Is all wrong.
The Sex Pistols caught the voice of a generation for sort of a split second, I think, with Anarchy. Mm. I think it was a great record, but that was meant to be like the starting point of something, and it was to encourage other people to play and to do things.
I want to tell you that what you have to do when you get a new wave band on the set is funk them up. You've got to go, be outrageous, come on, rip your knickers off. Do whatever you're going to do. If you've got it, show it.
I must say that it was a difficult decision to make of a band that had never really been in a recording studio before, but we did make the decision of letting them go in and record themselves with a studio engineer as somebody to work the controls. And I think as long as we're careful to understand that what we see live is what we want to put on records, that showing that care and understanding of what the music is, we will then not destroy what the excitement there is in the music. But certainly if we apply the same techniques to recording a Clash as we record a heavy metal band, we will not end up with a very good recording of Clash.
I guarantee you, in 5 years' time, every so-called punk rock band, including the Pistols and whoever, will have strings on their records. But they'll be violent strings. They'll be aggressive strings.
Well, I think the danger at the moment is everybody's jumping on the bandwagon of going, rah, nah, 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 F this, F that, F everything. You know, there's been such an influx. Mm. It's the same thing, it's like the floodgates have opened. Mm. So, you get a lot of wallies and they just pick up your guitar and go, well, you know, they can do it, we can do it, I mean, they can't. Mm.
Susie and Steve of the Banshees talk about their first performance at the 100 Club Punk Festival in September 76.
What did you sing? The Lord's Prayer. And didn't you mix it with some mixed...
Yeah, every ridiculous song you could think of that we didn't like Twist and Shout.
The idea to do it was to play to bore the pants off everyone, so they'd chuck us off. But in the end, we got more bored than everyone else and went off the stage.
The Maniacs.
I came from New York. I had a couple of bands there, two bands there, Cold Fever, and just forming Kamikaze. And then I came to London because there's so much happening.
There's a big change with the punk thing already. You know, the general energy buzz, which was kind of like with the Roxy album, you know, that's all kind of dissipated a bit now, and it's going into more songs. You know, people are getting more interested in songs and just sound. You know,
it's a shame when everybody kind of copies everybody else. They kind of should be trying to be a little bit individual. It's right to get certain ideas off of other people and that, but then it's what you do with those ideas that really counts, that you put something of you sort of into it.
I mean, you're getting live bands that can go and they can see people playing, go, oh, yeah, what's he doing there? He's, you know, they're getting sort of heroes that they can relate to. Because, mm-hmm. you know, all this thing of people saying, oh, you know, no hero. Oh, well, of course people want heroes. People want people to live out things that they can't actually do.
A lot of people seem to think we're fascists.
No, Nazis.
Why is that?
Because there's a certain badge that I like mm-hmm. because of its shape, and I like to wear it.
The Dutch cross.
Yeah.
They don't like that because it's war and fascist. They don't like that.
So
they associated punk and fascist. I think they are not fascist.
All this media thing about, they cause all the violence, you know, good copy, they don't care about. People don't care anymore about people in the street. Ordinary, normal people just don't care. People have never wanted people to get on. It's always been this control and this manipulation, and now they're trying to take this whole new way. I don't know, punk is an American homosexual, you know, back in the 50s, it's got nothing to do with it, really. It's just a word, they stick a label on you. But I think some good things are going to come out of it. Definitely.
I think the aggressive stance will grow and I think they'll get together with ladies and they'll have babies and the babies will be phenomenal.
Polystyrene, the singer of X-Ray Spex, talks about her name and the inspiration for her songs.
For polystyrene, out of the yellow pages, under plastics.
And what about the name of the band?
Oh, it's sort of out of a poem book, you know, these little glasses that you sort of put on to see new ladies through and things. They're not real though, really. That's why I called it X-Ray Spex. I don't think of myself as a girl singing rock and roll. I just think of myself as a person doing something, and that's it. And I suppose other people think of it like that, but I don't. Well, I don't know why they think of it like that, but it's just that they've got closed minds, that's all.
Polly, tell me a bit about what happened with your last single, Bondage Up Yours. I mean, does everyone assume that it must be sexual bondage then?
Yeah, I think they probably do. Not everybody. I mean, I don't know. He just said he didn't understand it. I think a lot of people, they just don't understand it. And what they don't understand, they don't want to know.
What were you talking about when you wrote the song? What was your idea behind
it? I was just talking about all forms of bondage, you know, repression, everything else. And sexual bondage stems from that. So it's all part of the same thing, really. It all depends which way you interpret it.
So it's much to do with social bondage as sexual bondage?
Yeah, it's to do with it all bondage. And it's bondage because it hasn't been played. That proves it as well. That is bondage in itself. Well, it's just about, you know, everybody's kind of looking to identify with something, that's all, really. That's all, it's just saying identity. It's a crisis, can't you see?
Identity. I'm
it should be about fun as well. It's about trying to say something as well. You know, it shouldn't be just about one thing. It should be about lots of things and just, you know, doing something new, something for now, that's all. New generation doing something as opposed to looking at, you know, old people doing things.
It'll stay, yeah, for, I'd say, another year at least.
Oh. This will be definitely the movement of this decade.
This is it. It's the next trend in music. This is the next big thing that we've been looking for. Everyone was looking for one act, you know, rather than total clear-out time, you know, which is what's happened. You know?
I mean, this whole thing is creating... it's making the 70s what it should have been. Up till now, nothing happened. I mean, it was going to go down as one of the most boring decades in history, I should think, musically, fashion-wise. And the 1970s have become a landmark in history, I think, now, because of what's going on. And it's all to do with young people.